following interview was conducted with Bob Jesse for the Purdue University Oral History Project. It took place on Tuesday, December the 5th, 2006, at his home in Fort Wayne. The interviewer is Katherine Markee, the oral history librarian. Okay, welcome. Can you tell us a little bit about your early life and where you were born and your parents?
I was born in Fort Wayne in 1924, which is a long time ago, and to my mother and my father, both German, and they were married, and of course, and I had four sisters who were all older than me, only one of which is living. My mother and my father broke up. My father left my mother when I was 6 years old and walked out and left her with her kids. And he remarried without getting a divorce, so he was not held in high esteem by me. My mother raised us kids, and she worked doing menial work, cleaning houses, and all those sort of things. She had a high school education, and that was as far as she'd gone. And I'm not sure she had even graduated from high school. She was a wonderful, wonderful woman, and did a wonderful job raising a family through the Depression. And I still remember those days when we would stand in a line getting free food, although she never would accept anything except that she'd work for it. And so it was a wonderful, we didn't think we were poor, everybody else was poor, and we had just a wonderful time as a, growing up as a family. And she did a marvelous job keeping us all together.
Did you go to grade, what about grade school? Did you go to high school
went
here? Tell us about high school.
Went to grade school here and went to high school here. And
what high school did you go
Central
to?
Central High School, which is now has been closed for quite some time. I like to think they've made a national shrine out of it, but that's not the case.
Was there any particular activities or clubs that you belonged to or remember in high school?
Not anything of any significance. I was in charge of a movie projecting group that showed movies for classes, and I thought that was a big deal at the time. And it was in high school that I met my wife Donna, who we were in the same homeroom together in high school. And so that was a wonderful experience that I had in high school. The best thing ever happened to me is meeting her.
Were you in the same class? You graduated the same
time? No, same year. Uh-huh. Yes, we both graduated in 1942. She was in college prep, and the reason I went to Central High School was not in the district in which I lived, but I wanted to, they offered vocational training, and I went there to learn how to become a pattern maker. And that's what I was in when I graduated. I was not intending to go to college at that time. Then the war came along, Second World War.
Did you serve in the war? Were you in the U.S. or outside?
Well, I was in the United States Merchant Marine. And you familiar with that group?
Yes.
And I had a high draft number when I was in high school when the war began. And back then, everybody wanted to get in the military and do something, and I didn't want to wait until I got drafted, and so I tried to enlist in various branches, and their quotas were filled. So I met a couple of friends who had enlisted in the Merchant Marine after we were, a friend of mine and I were trying to enlist together. Left the recruiting office unsuccessful again, and met these two guys. They said, "Well, what'd you do?" I said, "Well, we enlisted." I said, "What?" "We enlisted in the Merchant Marine." I said, "You did?" "Yeah, what's that?" They said, "Well, they got ships and so on, and they
go on
take
the water.
Supplies and they go on the water and we decided to walk down there and talk to the recruiter. And we did, and he gave us a really big song and dance and promised things that were not going to happen in the Merchant Marine. And we enlisted. And I went home, and my mother was all right with me trying to get in the Naval Air Force or the Army Air Force or the Marines or something. And I went home, and she said, well, did you, were you accepted this time? And I said, well, I enlisted. And she said, in what? And I said, the Merchant Marine. And she said, you what? Because it was pretty.
It was not Annapolis or West Point, right?
No, it was pretty dangerous thing. So I enlisted that and went in, did my training out in Brooklyn and shipped out and I stayed in there until I got injured in, 62 years ago in November of 44. Ship was torpedoed, and we were abandoning ship. The ship hadn't sunk yet, and I was in a lifeboat still right alongside the ship, and they fired another torpedo at the ship because it hadn't sunk, and it hit the ship directly under my lifeboat, blew it to a million pieces, and everybody in it except me. So I was the only survivor. Spent a lot of months in a hospital in England, and then came back here and was in a hospital in the United States, a couple of hospitals in New York and Chicago, and then finally got out. And
very lucky.
Very lucky.
Yes.
And granted, I was fortunate enough to start courting her real heavy. And she finally agreed that she'd think about marrying me. So we got engaged in...
When did you get married?
We got married in 1948. She was at IU, and I started at Purdue.
How did you happen to select Purdue?
Well, I'd always...
Were you eligible for the GI Bill?
No, I wasn't. Oh. The Merchant Marines weren't eligible for the GI Bill or any disability money or anything. They just didn't get anything. As a matter of fact, my pay stopped them. Day that ship was torpedoed, so I had to go back to New York a couple of times as a specialist. I had to pay my way to get back to the only stayed at YMCA because that's all I could afford. Didn't have to pay for the doctor, but everything else I had to pay for. It was kind of early on I was pretty bitter about it. When I was down at Purdue, I saw guys down there that had the little scar on her toe that were getting a GI Bill and had a disability pay. And I was bitter for a while, wrote letters to the president and congressman, and that didn't do any good, but I got over that in a hurry. That was just a short one. I didn't think the guys that got the GI Bill didn't deserve it. I just kind of thought that maybe
all the services
of us should, but anyway, we didn't. So I'd always thought I'd kind of like to be an engineer, and she encouraged me to go to school and get that I could do that, and I wasn't prepared for it academically because of the courses I'd taken in high school. So I had to take some remedial courses at Purdue for no credit, like algebra and trigonometry and geometry. And got through that all right, and did pretty well at Purdue, and got out in 4 years in civil engineering, and...
And what was the next step after that?
Well, I got out in 49, we'd been married for a year, we got married in my senior year. She graduated from Indiana School of Nursing, and then I was doing some helping with a research project for a soils engineer by the name of Dr. Fatum, who I liked real well, and he liked me. And
was he on the staff?
Yes. He taught soils mechanics. He, after he left Purdue, went to North Carolina and became the dean of engineering down there. He's a very bright guy and a nice guy. And with somebody here in Fort Wayne by the name of Harry Curtis, who was just starting a construction company. And Dr. Fadem had done some consulting work for Mr. Curtis, and Mr. Curtis called him and said, "Hey, I'm thinking about hiring a young engineer. Do you have anybody you could recommend?" And he was fortunate, recommended me. Well, Curtis, I went to work immediately after school because this thing with Harry Curtis didn't work out. It was going to, but he said, "Now, I'm going to be honest with you. If we get this contract that we're working toward getting up in Toledo," he said, "I can use you, but if I don't get it, I'm sorry, but we're just starting out. I can't use it." Well, he didn't get the contract, so just before I graduated, I didn't have a job. I had a pregnant wife, and so I applied to the Indiana State Highway Commission, and they were anxious to take people all the time. And so I went to work for them, designing reinforced concrete bridges, until December that year when Mr. Curtis called again and said, "Hey, we got a contract now, I can use you, are you still interested?" And I said, "You bet." So I gave my 2 weeks notice and started on the second day of January 1950 with a little baby. We had a son born on Christmas Day before then, and moved up here to Fort Wayne and
back home,
lived with my sister for a little while, and then we moved in, lived in a garage for a while, and it was an experience. Then the company blossomed. Specialized in wastewater treatment plant and water treatment plant construction, became one of the best in the country, and were recognized as such, and a graduate of Purdue by the name of Don Burnham, who is the CEO of Westinghouse, decided in the late 60s that he wanted to get involved in developing relationship and developing a company or division that would benefit men. And so he decided he wanted to get into environmental issues, and Westinghouse bought our company in 1969, and we became a subsidiary of Westinghouse Electric Company. I became president of it. It became an international company, and we had a big office in Atlanta, we had an office in California, we had a subsidiary company in Australia, did work in places like Ecuador and Panama, and it was a big operation, got to be a big operation.
The headquarters remained here, though, for the subsidiary?
Yeah, we remained here. The headquarters remained here. The name of the company was Seaboard Construction. I was traveling all the time. Just, we had our own airplane, and I traveled many times to Australia, and being the subsidiary of Westinghouse, we were just a little pipsqueak company as far as Westinghouse was concerned, but big as far as the construction company. And they had got into some financial difficulties, and that kind of rubbed off on Seaboard Construction, and got to be the wedding fun, and I was traveling all the time away from my family. If they said to do this, I had to jump and do it, and so I decided to quit. Had enough of it, and so I did. And a few months later, I bought another construction company here in Fort Wayne from a friend of mine, and had it as a hobby, and developed that into a bigger company, and then just this year finished the liquidation of that company. And so now I'm no longer involved in construction, which was my love. But along the way, last 15 years, I bought some other companies that were unrelated to construction. Still have three of them, and they occupy my time. I'm smart enough to have developed some really good manager, and I'm smart enough to know that when things are going well, don't screw it up.
good point. Leadership building right there.
Yeah.
I want to ask, you were appointed, you've been on the board of, how did you happen to get on the board of trustees? And sort of tell us a little bit about that. You were there when President Barron was selected, right?
I was there.
You know, there's a search going on now, I'm sure.
Yes.
Yes.
I was there. I was appointed when Art Hansen was the president.
Oh, okay.
And an individual in Fort Wayne was on the board of trustees, and he died, and there was a year left on his tour. And I was interviewed along with some other people to take over the last year of his appointment on the board, or election on the board. He was an alumni trustee as well, so he's an elected trustee. And I was fortunate enough to be selected to fill his unexpired term. And then after that happened, I guess it didn't screw up too bad. They asked me to continue on, which I did, and I did that for 23 years.
What was the term of the appointment? You were an alumni representative,
yes,
correct?
Yes, so I was elected every 3 years.
Every 3 years, okay.
And so I was on 23 years. I was chairman of the board for 4 years. And this has been an absolute fantastic experience. I learned, I thought I knew something about Purdue, but I didn't know anything about it until I got on the board. Then we had to go through the process of hiring a new president when Dr. Hansen resigned to take on the job in Texas. And was a member of the search committee and interviewed a lot of individuals and made the final selection of Dr. Barry, which is one of the things I'd like to say I claim total credit for hiring him, but that's not the case. But
I won't ask you. I won't say anything.
Yeah. But we were.
That's a long process.
It's a very long process.
Let me ask you this: did they have an outside executive firm at that time as well?
Not to begin with.
Oh, okay.
And then we're.
You know, the news says that they have one for the current one.
Yeah, and they did with Dr. Gisty. And outside.
Oh, I see.
The same firm, as a matter of fact.
Okay.
The same. I'd say the senior officer of the firm helped with Dr. Gisty as well as the one now. But we didn't to begin with.
With Dr. Barron?
With Dr. Barron. And then later on during the process, we determined that we probably ought to have a little help. Initial selection of the candidates, which we did. And then we were just fortunate to get Dr. Barry. He was just a wonderful guy, and I'll tell you the story. We decided that he was going to be the individual we wanted, so we invited him. Nobody was living in Westwood then when Art Hansen left. The place was vacant. John Hicks was acting president at that time, and he chose not to. So we asked Steve and Jane to come up and have dinner at Restwood and meet the rest of the trustees. There were three trustees on the search committee at that time, and we interviewed all the candidates and decided, the three of us had decided that we should offer the job to Dr. Barron, subject to the approval of the rest of the board of trustees. And we told him. Dinner, have him and Jane invited to dinner in Westwood, and he came, and we socialized and had dinner, and the rest of the trustees got a chance to spend a lot of time with him, well, an hour and a half or so, and visit with him and ask him questions. They, like the other three of us, felt that he had just great credentials and warm, pleasant, genuine guy. So I was the vice chairman at the time. Don Powers was the chairman, and Don said to Steve, he said, Dr. Barron, Bob and I would like to take you down to the lower level of Westwood here just chatted with me a little bit. We went down there and talked a little bit. And Don said, we would like for you to become the next president of Purdue University. And Steve just was flabbergasted. A couple of tears rolled down his cheeks. And he said, I cannot think of a higher honor. He said, I would pledge to you this. He said, I will devote all my energies and all my time and all my love for this university. Just as long as I'm on here, I will not have anybody that will try harder to do what's right for this great, great institution. And that's stuck with me all these years. And he did. He did just what he said he was going to do. So then I had decided to retire after 23 years.
From the trustees?
From the trustees. And we're just in the tail end of that process of replacing Bearing, and I got in the initial stages of the selection. But I was gone before the interviewing process was going on, so I had very little to do other than since I'd been in on the process before, the trustees asked me to kind of get involved in it and tell them what went right and what went wrong and so on and so forth.
Using your expertise and especially.
Yeah, that's right.
That's
right.
Right.
Yep.
Do they do, they bring the people to campus, but to do some interviews off campus, and can that vary with what they want to do?
Well, they don't bring them to campus. It's a, most of the candidates that you want aren't looking for a job. You get hundreds of resumes from people who think that they're qualified to run Purdue University. And clearly, you read some of them, you're not. The ones that you want are not looking for a job. And they are employed, either as a president or maybe a provost or a vice president or anyway. They have experience running a university, or a major part of it at least. And so we would set up meetings in secret, because if the people that we were interested in, aren't looking for a job, and they don't want their current board to know that they're, so we would meet in strange places, fly in and just get together with it unannounced. And then when we got to the point where we were serious about the two or three candidates, we'd have them come to campus and visit there. But then the word was out at that point.
Meet with the people.
Yeah, you couldn't keep that a secret. So. The thing that I stressed to the committee that was searching for Dr. Juski is that confidentiality is just so critical. But a couple of times we had some candidates and word had leaked out. I said, I'm sorry, remove my name from the list. And
very touchy.
Yep. So it was a well, it's a, I think, the most important job that the Board of Trustees have is the selection of a president to run the university. And it's, it was kind of stressful because it's a big job and it took a lot of time.
Think sometimes people realize the amount that
we just went all over to a lot of places and read a lot, talked to people, and interviewed folks. And it was a time consuming process that but it was really. Very rewarding when you get the right individual.
That's right. It all pays off.
It pays off.
That's right. On the trustees, you're involved, the trustees are involved in a lot of things. Are there any other comment or special things you interact somewhat with the legislature? You're involved in the budget.
The budget is a big issue with the Board of Trustees. Mm-hmm. And the setting of goals and a strategic plan is very, very critical.
Okay.
Let me
closes. The sun is making a square.
Quinn.
And the budget is a really big...
Is a big important process of the work of the Board of Trustees, but it's in a state of flux all the time. You cannot depend on what the state legislators are going to do.
Right.
As far as their participation, fundraising becomes more and more critical. Of course, the percentage of money that is being contributed to the university by the taxpayers is going down. And so there's two things that you can do. Either raise more money, or else the quality of the institution is going to go down. And all trustees, when I was there, and all the current trustees whom I know quite well, are dead set against that. But it's just not going to happen. If anything, we're going to improve a good thing. And so fundraising then becomes a part of the work of the trustees. And on one occasion, when I was the chairman, Dr. Bering and I and our wives and Dean of School of Engineering, Henry Yang at that time, you probably remember him, flew to Taiwan and to Hong Kong in a total of 5 days, over and back, and visited both alumni groups at that time. As a fundraising thing, we were gone 5 days and came back with $11 million, which was not too bad.
Paid for the flight.
Yeah, and so when we got back, and I reported to the other trustees, they said, well, why don't you get back on an airplane and go someplace else for another 5 days?
Let me change the course just for a minute. How do you think the campus has changed since you've been a student there? Certainly the physical structure has changed.
Oh, the physical structure has just changed enormously. Just unbelievable. From the fact that now it's a pedestrian campus instead of parking all over. Physical facilities of buildings are far superior to anything that I was involved in when there as a student. I think the quality of the education has improved. The diversity obviously is a big change. From a minority standpoint and from a women's standpoint, and in my class in civil engineering, there were 3 women, for example, and now it's about, I understand it's probably 40%. The atmosphere has changed. And keep in mind, I'm kind of old. It's far more liberal than it was when I was there, from the standpoint of even how males and females interact in residence halls. And when I lived in Cary the 3 years that I was there, and I moved out when I got married and lived off campus. So when I lived in Cary, and keep in mind, most of us guys in Cary were over 21 years old. So we were old, and war seems to age you a lot quicker, too. And we're more mature, I think. Do more what we wanted. But on the other hand, we're 21 years old, and we thought we ought to be able to have a beer. Well, if you were caught with a beer in Cary Hall, you were really admonished. You caught the second time, you're kicked out. That doesn't happen anymore. And you absolutely couldn't get to Windsor Hall if you're a male. You could get in the reception area, and that's as far as you could go. And so that has changed dramatically. Things like, even though we're 21 years old, we didn't have anything like this breakfast club.
was less motivation to earn a degree in 4 years now than it was back then. We had fun, of course, but nothing like what goes on now. I have to tell you, in all honesty, I don't like it. But that's the way it is. Change is inevitable.
You were talking about the physical thing. How has the village changed? Sometimes they ask people that, how it's changed since you were a student there. Has it changed very much, the village?
The only thing there was a dry tie that I remember.
Harry's
chocolate bar was there.
Right.
And a dry tie and the bookstore on the same, I can't remember the name of the one that's on the same street, side of the street as Harry's.
Oh, Vons?
Yeah.
Vons is there now.
Yeah, it wasn't called on. Yeah. And there was a barber shop there, I don't know if that's still there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But the village was just non-existent, and the levee was a big dump at that time. And
wasn't Bruno's there?
Bruno's was there, uh-huh. But very little others.
Weren't there any gas stations? There was nothing down there?
I don't remember a gas station at all.
It was just nothing.
Just nothing.
Well, State Street would go down, and you could go to Lafayette, could you not? I mean, it ran, but anything around there, there wasn't very much of anything.
No. Between State Street and Brown Street, it was just a dump.
Hmm.
They unloaded trash in there, and old dead trees, and so on. What?
Those leaves.
Why?
It'd be easier.
Oh, we'll wait till it's finished.
We want to wait till it's finished.
Yeah, we'll wait.
He wants to wait till we're finished, cool. Okay?
Yeah, that's okay. Good. That's interesting, though.
Yeah.
But there were some shops in the village, weren't there? Grocery or any clothing or nothing like that?
There were a couple, but not very many, Katherine.
Huh.
I don't think there were many at all.
Huh.
I don't recall if there was. Of course, where Cranes is, there are just houses in there at that time. So it's changed dramatically.
Yes, I would say so. Are you still, being an alum, are you still active in the Alumni Association as well?
Yeah, I'd say so.
Okay.
Uh-huh. We go to a lot of different functions, and when you're an elected trustee, you are non-voting member of the Alumni Association, and it's expected that you're going to attend their all their meetings, which you do, because you are an alumni trustee, you're elected by the alumni.
Okay.
You don't get to vote at those occasions, but they still ask your opinion once in a while, and you're given the opportunity to say a few words, which we all do. So.
There's a pretty active chapter up here, too, of the alumni?
Yep.
Fort Wayne?
Mm-hmm. There is. Mm-hmm. Very active.
It's probably grown a lot over the years, too.
Mm.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, tomorrow night, we have every year after the Indiana-Purdue game, we have the old Oaken Bucket dinner here. They bring the old Oaken Bucket up, and Joe Tiller will be here, and probably Morgan Burke. And we have a nice dinner.
You've been doing that every year?
Oh, for a long, long, long
That's
time.
That's wonderful.
Yeah. The old Oaken Bucket.
Do you have some of the players come? Or?
No, not the players.
Just the alumni and the coach?
And some of the staff, yeah. Uh-huh. And we have a great time with that.
Oh, you get to see the bucket, right?
Oh, yeah.
You know, one of the things on the board, was that student board of the member of trustees, has that affected the trustees, or is it nice to have the student that started in 75, I think?
Yep, it started, I got on the board in 76,
okay.
And the first student trustee was a young lady, and I would have to tell you, we have had outstanding student members of the board of trustees. They are, they are, members of the board. They have the same authority, same responsibility as any other board, and they have really been outstanding young people to make a great contribution. One of the things that we had to caution them about is that you don't represent any constituency when you're a trustee. You represent the university. You should, and I think all are, there for the betterment of the university, regardless of whether it affects their thinking or not, specifically. But you cannot be a trustee and just be an advocate of the students and look at what's good for the students and the heck with the rest of the university. You can't do that. We had, we'd have to kind of indoctrinate them a little bit, that, but they all...
So what the role is, and explain, explore.
Yeah, just have to explain it to them. And then we would have to do that with some new adult trustees who would come on once in a while. They would have kind of some things, their own agenda once in a while. And when you're the chairman, you're expected to set off the rules a little bit.
Right, okay.
Which was not always pleasant, but...
Some of the other activities you're involved in on the trustees, of course, the budget and the search and the president, but also outstanding or distinguished alumni involved in some of that to some extent. And that, that enhances, I think, the university and working with the people, working the selection and how they get selected, et cetera.
Well, theoretically, the trustees hire everybody who works for the university. Now, that responsibility and that approval process is designated to the president, and he gives that authority to the dean and so on. But the trustees always approve any of the, of course, the president and the vice presidents, and any of the deans, heads of departments, always approval of the trustees, and then the other folks are the responsibility and authority is delegated to other people. And that's very critical because the heart of the university is the faculty, and I think the faculty is only as good as the deans, and I think the deans are as good as the president, and so on. So it's a process that the trustees take very, very seriously in approving the appointment of deans and other folks of that caliber, and it's a thoughtful process in which a lot of questions are asked. Sometimes early on in the process, it's been developed that maybe we ought to take another look. Not often, but occasionally, because the process that's used to bring them to the board is pretty darn thorough, and they, as you know, they have a selection committee.
Sure.
That if,
no,
if
thank you. I'm fine. I take it black.
If they do a thorough job, which they all do, the candidates that are generally recommended to the board are pretty darn thoroughly. They're thoroughly allocated. They're thoroughly analyzed, and it's really pretty good process.
So by the time it gets there, it's pretty well?
Pretty well established and thought through. And we always, and I'm sure we still do, I always got the vita, and a lot of recommendations, get copies of those recommendations. People that have known and know about what their research history has been, what their fundraising activities have been as far as receiving grants. And it's well thought out.
What's the liaison with the trustees and the Purdue Research Foundation? Is there any, how does that work?
Well, I happen to be a director of the Purdue Research Foundation.
While you were on the trustees, or is this a separate appointment?
This is a separate appointment, although the chairman is always, when I was a chairman, I was on the Purdue Research Foundation Board, and when I was no longer chairman, then I was not, then I was appointed back again. I've been on it for a long time now. The Purdue Research Foundation's function is to serve Purdue University in the best way it possibly can. It receives funds and grants, about 4 or 5% of the income of the foundation is used for the benefit of Purdue. It is a vehicle in which it can own properties and dispose of them without having to go through the lengthy process that's owned by Purdue University. It's a very lengthy process of getting approvals from the governor and the budget commission and the appraisals and that whole thing. And so it's a vehicle that's used that expedites benefits that can accrue to Purdue University by virtue of that. People make a contribution to the Purdue Research Foundation, it's still a tax write-off. And the Research Foundation owns a great number of buildings, which they lease, and which we have several buildings house incubator companies that are just beginning.
At the park.
And some of them are developing the really first-rate things and have paid dividends back to the Research Foundation. And the Board of Trustees, when they set the salaries, for example, Research Foundation follows that same percentage that is granted to the university. And there's a lot of cooperation between the Purdue Research Foundation and the faculty. Some of them are paid by the Research Foundation. And it's just a great relationship that has worked very, very well. And as you probably know, Purdue's Research Foundation has gotten a number of awards nationally for what an outstanding entity it is, what they've done and be able to accomplish. And it's been the state is recognized as a great contributor to the economic development of the state of Indiana. It's just a wonderful thing, and I'm privileged to serve on that board.
David Ross got that started, didn't he?
Yes, he did.
Yes, he did.
Yeah. Very, very energetic. He was a visionary.
What? If I asked you this, what would be your most memorable event in your life? Do you think of something?
At Purdue?
Anything that sort of sticks in your mind. Could be at Purdue.
Marrying her. Marrying my wife.
Okay. And when you look back on one of the things, as you know, this is going to be turned over to the Archives and Special Collections, and for researchers, if there's something that you might make a comment to researchers when they're studying the history of the university, because this is one of the things that can use the oral history as they're trying to enhance, you know, the history of the university. We don't have a lot of written things, and that's what the oral history is going to supplement, I think. So if you have some comments on the university or something that kind of sticks in your mind, how it's changed or what the researchers might benefit by, just in summary of your experience.
Well, Purdue to me will always be and should always be a comprehensive university with the emphasis on engineering and science. That's where we've come from, and that's where we've made our mark. And I hope that we continue to emphasize those areas because they're very good at it. And there have been a number of very successful and outstanding individuals who come out of Purdue in those areas. Now, that's not to say that the liberal arts is not an important function of the university, because it is. It's the basis. As a matter of fact, I think engineering ought to be a 5-year program, because it's there's so much technical studies that you have to make that doesn't give you enough time for other things that are important. Communicating, for example, is engineers historically are considered to be poor, poor communicators. They're good at pluses and minuses, but they're short on communication, and I think that's true. But the university as a whole, I think, is in an outstanding place, as evidenced by all the awards and recognition we get. And I think, I hope there's never complacency about the situation, so that they think, well, we can't get any better, well, we can. And Dr. Gisty really emphasized that Purdue is very, very good, but there's room for improvement. I think that to be a preeminent university, as he wants us to be, and I think we are, requires money. And the results of his fundraising are just absolutely outstanding. But that has to be done and has to be continued. And I would hope that the next president's going to continue in that vein, because the state's portion of the expense is going down, maybe not in dollars, but as a percentage. And if we don't do that, then if we don't get private funding, then tuition goes up, and become less attractive to students, and some students